impacting, but if you're releasing, you know, a couple of gigatons of carbon, they don't like it. And so, actually, if you look at the extinction in the deep sea, way back in 2004, Discover magazine had this story and said that at the end of the Paleocene epoch, you know, we had this carbon isotopic event. Not much that we care about died then. Okay, define we. And actually, my son read this in high school, and so he comes home and says, "See, we always told you no one cares about your stuff." So. They never forgive me that as a paleontologist mom, I didn't study something fancy like dinosaurs. But so about 30 to 50% of the common deep sea species went extinct. And so the question is why? And so if you look at cosmopolitan deep sea species, we do not have genetic information on many. I'm kind of showing the three species on which we do have information. There's a couple more. However, if you look at them genetically, then all those three species are genetically pretty much identical between the Arctic and the Antarctic. And that's kind of as far as you can go in the present-day world. And so someone has actually measured the maximum speed of benthic forams, who move much slower after you fed them. And the absolute maximum speed is about 88 microns per minute, which translates into 46 meters per year, if I didn't mess up my unit. And so it takes a long time for a benthic foram to walk from the Arctic to the Antarctic. And so the argument is then, of course, that they have a motile state, which is actually spread through ocean currents to the bottom benthic layer, that makes that those populations are pretty much globally mixed. And so that means that you have to think, you know, if you talk about the ubiquity of small organisms, that means that at least some of the common species of benthic forams are, you know, more or less like dandelion seeds, right? They kind of move everywhere, and whenever there's a place where they can function, they actually grow up and mature. This has been confirmed by studies by Sue Goldstein and Elizabeth Alvey, in which they take mud and they sieve it, so there's no forams present that you can see, and then they incubate it, and suddenly there's all kinds of forams. And so if you don't have spontaneous generation, then that means that there is some motile states in there. And the interesting thing is that they grow benthic forams that are not known as adult from that specific location. Oops. Did I flip anything off, or is it something else? All right, I will have to tell you the rest without images. Do I still have time? I still have time. There we go. My computer is back, but...
The screen here needs to be.
Oh, that screen needs to be.
I just touched it, so it should come up.
All right, so the next thing I'm going to... The next thing I'm going to mention is that in view of what I've been talking about for the end of the Cretaceous, when we had a big extinction in surface organisms that provide the food to benthic foraminifera, that I would have predicted, and I actually did predict and published on it, that there would be a big extinction of benthic forams when the planktonic organisms went extinct. And that wasn't true. Then I would have argued from this information on where we see how many benthic forams and that they're globally present in the deep sea, so, you know, you kill them off in one place and they come back. You know, with the Pinatubo extinction, a lot of forams went extinct, disappeared locally just after the extinction, and then they come back half a year later from somewhere else. And so, as such, I would have argued, and again, I did argue this, that it is pretty much impossible to have a true extinction of benthic forams. Because whenever I kill off, so in the deep ocean, because if I kill them in one place, they will come back from somewhere else. And so, both of those predictions were wrong. There was, in fact, a major extinction of benthic forams. So I would have predicted that a major extinction at the sea surface would lead to a deep sea extinction through lack of food, and that was wrong. And then I would have argued that major extinction in deep sea don't occur, and that was wrong as well. So, well, it keeps you busy. And so if you look at, this is a very simple plot with not a lot of data, but if you just look at rarefied species diversity across the Cretaceous Paleocene, across the Paleocene-Eocene boundary, Cretaceous Paleocene in red, Paleocene Eocene in blue, then you can see at the same location actually, this is the Southeast Atlantic and this is the Southern Ocean, then you can see that your benthic forearms don't really care about impacting asteroids, but they get really kind of nervous, and many of them go extinct at a time that we have something going on with the carbon cycle. And so if you kind of put this on a simplified plot, if you look at pelagic calcifiers, such as planktic forearms and calcareous nanoplankton, they show severe extinction at the end of the Cretaceous, whereas in the benthic forearms you see something like temporary assemblage changes, but there is no significant extinction in the deep sea. If I look at the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum, then it's kind of the reverse. There's, you have a pelagic calcifiers that show temporary assemblage changes, migration, some evolution of short-lived species, but we have a severe extinction, particularly of common and cosmopolitan species in deep-sea benthic forearms. And so what we in essence see is a decoupling in the extinction of calcifiers in the pelagic waters and in the deep sea. And so in 2012, we wrote this review paper on ocean acidification at times in the past. And one of the things that Andy Ritzwell was playing with Earth system modeling is that if you play games with rates of things, then you see that rates of change are very important in the effects of ocean acidification, as in many other things that have to do with life on Earth. And you know, this came out of the famous argument, you know, in the geological past, it was very, very warm. And you know, in the Cretaceous, we think that the atmospheric CO2 was very, very high. And you know, there's the cliffs of Dover, so there were lots of pelagic calcifiers around at times of high atmospheric PCO2. And you know, how is that possible if you now keep saying that ocean acidification is going to be bad for things? And the answer is the rates of things. So if you look, the colors here means times, going from instantaneous to 10 to the first, 10 to the second, 10 to the third, 10 to the fourth, 10 to the fifth. This is the ratio of flood basalts and things like that, say 100,000 years. This is fossil fuel emissions, say 100 years. If we plot mean ocean surface saturation for aragonite, in this case, calcite shows something similar, to mean surface pH, then you see that if you increase the atmospheric CO2 very rapidly, then you find a very strong correlation between the mean surface pH and mean ocean surface saturation. The slower this goes, the more this gets decoupled. So the trajectories of mean ocean surface pH and saturation become progressively decoupled as the rate of atmospheric PCO2 decreases. And so if you look at relatively slow rates on millennia or less, then we affect the surface ocean less and the deep sea more, and we see carbonate dissolution in the deep sea. And so what we're getting is, in essence, you start, if you put the CO2 in the atmosphere kind of slowly, on a time scale of the ocean overturn, then you're transporting it more and more into the deep ocean, where you dissolve calcium carbonate, so you buffer the system. And so, this finally, actually when we wrote this paper, this kind of clicked in my mind, since I was talking about decoupling of extinction of surface calcifiers and deep calcifiers, and here we're talking about decoupling of what goes on with carbonate saturation, depending on rates of emission. And so what I then started to speculate about is that the decoupling of extinction in surface and bottom-dweller calcifying organisms may have to do with the rate of emission of carbon compounds or other acids. If there's time to penetrate into the deep ocean, you will dissolve limestones and kill off deep-sea benthic forearms. Whereas if you emit them very rapidly, then you will cause a strong acidification of surface waters which are in contact with the atmosphere. But in fact, you will have buffered the system before it can penetrate into the deep sea. So this will be very bad for stuff that calcifies in the surface waters, but not so much for the deep ocean. And so if you look at the end of the Cretaceous, you can argue that rapid ocean acidification, a combination of acids, because you threw an asteroid on sulfate-bearing limestones, liberating carbon dioxide as well as sulfates, and your asteroid went through the atmosphere, which it was heating up, so it made nitric acid, due to the asteroid impact, may have decimated the pelagic calcifiers, including phytoplankton and forearms and the aragonitic ammonites. But it was buffered before it could penetrate into the deep oceans. And this, of course, was very rapid effect. The primary productivity was then taken over by non-calcifying phytoplankton, such as diatoms and prokaryotes and dinoflagellates. And so it was not true that the total ocean productivity declined by 95-97%. The productivity by calcifiers declined. And so then the change in the ecosystem structure may have kept the biological pump going. And for instance, you could have increased jellyfish, which are good for the transport of organic matter, after the extinction of top-level predators and ammonites. I'm fantasizing here. If you then look at the speed at the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum, where we look at the time scale of from 0 to 8,000 years. And so this is from a paper by Zibi and Zekhaus in 2013, in which they argued that the PGM looks something like this orange bar, say 3,000 petagram carbon over a couple of thousand years. And this is us, fossil fuel burning, if you burn everything there is. About 5,000 petagram carbon in a few hundred years. And then the effect on the saturation, carbonate saturation of the surface waters during the PETM looked something like this. And this is what we're doing, we'll be doing, if you burn everything there is. Just a few weeks ago, Dick Seeby, Andy Ritzel, and Jim Zakos came out with a new paper. This was published on the 21st of March. So we're giving you the latest results. And they are arguing that the anthropogenic carbon release, again, is unprecedented during the past 66 million years. They put the Cretaceous-Tertiary boundary at 66, right, instead of 65. So that was possibly faster. But, you know, if you want to argue that, you know, we're as bad as an asteroid impact, you know, that's pretty bad. And so what they're actually using is a real novel model, since it's really, really difficult, if you have no annual layers, it's really, really difficult to estimate the timing of fast geological processes. And what they did here is a novel thing, is actually they used the carbon isotopic data, and the oxygen isotopic data at some sections with high sedimentation rates. And what they looked at, do we have leads or lags between the carbon isotopes, which tell you we're emitting isotopically light carbon, and the oxygen isotopes, which is warming. And we, in essence, see no offset between those things. And that means that actually your emission of carbon isotopes cannot have been on 13 years or something like that, because there is an offset in timing, as we know ourselves, between the emission of carbon isotopes and warming of the ocean. Because the oceans have a very high heat content, and so if we are starting to emit CO2 in the atmosphere, it takes a while to warm up the ocean. And so if those things are instantaneous in the record, then that means that our record does not resolve the time delay between emission of carbon isotopes and the warming of the ocean. And then they play all kinds of modeling games, which are too difficult for me, in which they figure this backwards and say, you know, what would this, the timing of the release be, seeing that we see no offset between those data? And they come up with a best estimate of 4,000 years. And if you then go back to the carbon isotopic, the size of the carbon isotopic excursion, and you make some estimates about how much that is, they come to a rate of 1.1 petagram of carbon per year. 2014, we were at 10 times as much. Ta-da. So, conclusion and speculations. I would argue that the decoupling of the extinction of planktic and benthic calcifiers could have been caused by different rates of ocean acidification. With faster rates, you affect the plankton and things that live in shallow water, such as coral reefs, and slower rates, we affect the deep-sea benthos. And so then the question remains whether future extinction due to anthropogenic ocean acidification will resemble those of the Cretaceous Paleogene or those of the PTM. And, you know, from the last couple of slides, you'll see that I'm starting to think that what we're doing will be closer to asteroid impacts than to carbon emissions. And so if you look at this, then I think that actually we will be closer to this way than to that way. And, you know, partially that is kind of encouraging, since, you know, for someone who is from Holland, as for people from Florida, global warming is kind of a worrisome idea, because you're kind of predicting that a large part of where you live will be underwater. And, you know, I always thought, well, you know, this is going to be a problem because my country is underwater and my favorite microfossils will go extinct. But, you know, by now I think that maybe my country will be underwater, but my favorite microfossils will be doing just yes, fine. So, thank you. Don't tell me you believe me.
I'm not an audiologist, so it's maybe a really obvious answer. Right. But when it comes to the PETM, right, and the potential release of methane hydrates,
yes,
is there any kind of, do the Milankovitch cycles match up with that at all? Or could it be any of like a change in irradiance that prompted the release?
Yes and no. So, as I was saying, there are a number of much smaller events in the record, a few small ones before the PETM, and a number of smaller ones afterwards, which we call hyperthermal events. And so they kind of line up with Milankovitch orbital variability, and they specifically line up with high eccentricity. However, although they all line up, the PETM just seems to be slightly different in the cycle than everything else. And so there the argument is, it seems to be a general process that was doing this, but you may have needed some extra kind of push for the PETM. So the answer is yes or no. Yes.
Do you think that, I mean, are any of those terrestrial mechanisms capable of...
Well, if you argue that you put it in the atmosphere first and then it penetrates throughout the ocean on the turnover of the ocean time, then even, an atmospheric release would work. Have it penetrate into the ocean on the ocean circulation timescale.
I guess I was thinking also the temperature.
Right. Well, kind of. So the question is, how fast can you possibly burn a continent worth of peat? And so I have no answer to that. However, someone has looked into this, of course. And so the people who looked into the peat burning hypothesis, they're arguing that you indeed have, very thick peat. Some of it are still there, so obviously they didn't burn since they're still there. But if you argue that some of them were burned, people are arguing on a timescale of burning of thousands of years. Since you're kind of burning rapidly at the surface and then it kind of goes slower at greater depths and things like that. But, what do I know about peat burning?
Studying oceanification in the modern world to understand.
Yes, I mean, the argument is always, can you predict about the future from the past? And so, some things we can. But, you start with a different world. The continents are in different places. Yeah. So, actually, of course, the Pacific was even much larger than today. So, the Pacific processes are going to be even more dominant than they are today, for instance. And you start in a warmer world where you have at least smaller ice caps than today. And then, again, the rates is a big question. In geology, our big problem is indeed figuring out rates. And since in many cases, we do not see the difference between 10,000 years and instantaneous. Unless you have those famous laminated sediments. And so I think, however, that we have, since 1991, we have indeed succeeded in narrowing down this timing. And, from just a very simple blink, I always thought it was considerably less than 20,000 years, because 20,000 years is an orbital periodicity, right? And so if you can, some sites can recognize what your orbital periodicity is, you can say, well, this was much less than 20,000 years. So, 4,000 or 5,000 years sounds kind of good to me. But, that is on a very coarse kind of resolution. I think one of the nice things is that with more and more data, we have gained an understanding, indeed, of the timing of those processes, which will be important for release of fossil fuel. In addition to that, when we kind of started this out, I think most of us were very naive. And so we kind of thought, you release this carbon into the oceanic system. Now, let's assume this was instantaneous to see what happens. And then we just measured it in all those different proxies. And of course, that's not the way it works, because there is an ecosystem there. And all kinds of organisms do not only react to the warming, but, they may change, for instance, plants may change their fractionation. And so the carbon isotopic surge that you see may be partial the biotic effects of the organism on the higher CO2 levels and partial the environmental signature. So I think the things that we have learned is to, be much more wary about what the actual effects are on specific bits and pieces of the ecosystem. Mm-hmm.
Fascinating. Any other questions? Oh, I've lost.
Just
Right.
Expansion.
Yeah.
And that is if you increase the temperature of the surface ocean by 5 degrees, you're going to increase metabolic rate.
Right.
So less primary production is going to get transported to the deep water.
Right, exactly. And so. But so it looks at least as if in coastal or a marginal basis you're overdoing, you're still overcoming that effect because of the increased nutrient. And I'm only saying that because we see, you know, the laminated black shales and we see the eutrophication in the coastal waters. That's the only reason that I say
and
that.
Even the increase in CO2 is going to increase your overall primary production in the
If you bring in enough of the nutrients.
No, it's not
The dwarfism of the mammals that I wasn't talking about. So the people who do the mammals are arguing that, in fact, the vegetation was growing faster, but the carbon nitrogen content was changing, and that, you know, the poor little horses had to eat so much grass that had not enough nutrients in them that they were dwarfed.
That's all methane.
Well, that was oxidized in a time scale of 10 or 11 years. That's,
I wanted to know how much of a possibility there may be that it's not necessarily an extinction, but just loss of benthic forms in the record through the conditions of the ocean.
They could don't come back.
No, that
in 55 million years they don't come back.
Is it possible that they're not preserved in
sediments? At that specific location, at some specific locations, they were not preserved. But the difference between an extinction and being temporarily away is that if they never ever come back in 55 million years anywhere in the oceans, then I think that they were dead. Extinction is forever. And in fact, the overall diversity of deep sea benthic forms has, until now, not recovered. It's not back to Paleocene levels today. Well, no. My favorite hypothesis, of which I don't know if a specific journal will accept the paper we just submitted, my favorite hypothesis is, of course, some